Nduru, Deputy Minister Bapela, the New Age Chief Executive Atul Gupta, and the Editor-in-Chief, Mr. Ryland Fisher, Dr. Ben Ngubane, Chairman of SABC, DG Magubane, and the senior officials of the Department of Energy as well as state-owned companies, esteemed guests and stakeholders, SABC viewers, energy mascots, ladies and gentlemen. Today, being Take a Girl Child to Work, I also want to acknowledge the girl children in the room, especially Kamogelo Mokoena, a grade 11 learner from World School Erasmus. Ladies and gentlemen, the South African government has embarked on an energy infrastructure capacity path to ensure security of energy supply, and is pursuing an energy plan that seeks to meet the needs of our growing economy without compromising our commitment to sustainable development by utilizing our fossil resources responsibly. Our response as South Africa to increasing energy security in the electricity space has been manifold, and the department has placed the Integrated Resource Plan, or IRP 2010, at the center of addressing this mandate. This energy mix plan ensures the optimization of costs, promotion of job creation, and mitigation against adverse climate change. It is the impact of the IRP on job creation that we would like to focus on today. You would be aware that the IRP sets a target of more than 42 gigawatts of new generation capacity up to 2020, with wind and solar allocated 8.4 gigawatts and 9.4 gigawatts respectively. Gas through both open and closed cycle gas turbines, a total of 6.3 gigawatts, and import hydro at 2.6 gigawatts, nuclear and coal at 9.6 and 6.3 gigawatts each. Notably, renewable sources will ultimately constitute 42% of all new generation capacity. In line with this policy imperative, we have selected a total of 47 preferred bidders under Window 1 and Window 2 of the Renewable Energy IPP Procurement Program for a total of 2,614 megawatts to be added to the grid by 2016. The investment in the program is projected to be about 100 billion rand over a period of 12 months. The investment will cover the supply, construction, maintenance, and operation of the power plants in the Western Cape, Northern Cape, Eastern Cape, and Free State. These provinces have the highest wind and solar resources in the country, and that is why project developers have preferred to make investments there. But also, as guided by our own studies, including the wind map, as well as the Atlas. In a similar way, it is expected that KwaZulu-Natal, Mpumalanga, and indeed our neighbors in Mozambique and Swaziland will dominate the biomass investment because of the sugar and paper industries being located there. Limpopo and Northwest have solar potential that is also substantial, and we expect that more projects will come from these provinces in future. Gauteng has land availability constraints, with land mainly used for housing development. It is our intention to facilitate the introduction of renewable technologies that do not require lots of land for their implementation, such as solar water heating, rooftop photovoltaic power generation, and landfill site gas development. We will introduce the small power or less than 5 megawatt capacity bidding round in the next few weeks, followed by the renewable energy cogeneration bidding round to harness the sugar and paper potential that promises to create new job opportunities. We continue to be seized with work around the Northern Cape Solar Corridor and remain keen to explore the potential of up to 5,000 megawatt solar generation in the identified areas. With regard to the objectives set for the green economy under the new growth path, the implementation of the IRP will make a significant contribution to stimulating the domestic green economy. Our over 12,000 construction-related and just above 1,000 permanent jobs are expected to be created under the program. There is still room for further optimization, particularly in ensuring that the foreign investment that we have attracted goes a long way in facilitating the transformation of the South African economy. The space that we have created through IPPs is meant to reduce the concentration of economic opportunity from established business to new enterprises led by previously disadvantaged individuals, including our women. One of the issues that we are confronted with is to maximize the participation of enterprises owned by HDIs in the program on the back of the foreign investment opportunities that arise from the green economy. As you might be aware, ladies and gentlemen, we have installed more than 250,000 solar water heating systems to date, with a target of 1 million by 2014. Whilst happy that we are on track, the majority of these systems, particularly the low pressure type, have been imported. This is clearly unsustainable, and the time has arrived for us to intervene decisively if we are to make a difference in creating local job opportunities. We must reiterate, only those suppliers who commit to localize their product will be able to participate in the government-funded subsidy program. Over the next 3 years, we will spend 4.7 billion on this program. And my view is that we cannot export the job creation potential that this allocation has. Cabinet, ladies and gentlemen, has established the National Nuclear Energy Executive Coordinating Committee to provide oversight and monitor the nuclear expansion program. This committee is comprised of the Departments of Energy, Water Affairs, Public Enterprises, National Treasury, Science and Technology, Trade and Industry, and Economic Development, and is led by His Excellency Deputy President Kgalema Motlanthe. We are evaluating our processes against the International Atomic Energy Agency's milestones for countries engaged in the construction of nuclear power plants. At the right time, the Deputy President will convene this committee to provide guidance and direction on this important aspect of our electricity expansion program, especially with regard to the procurement and financing frameworks. The delivery model is intended to maximize the extent of localization of the program, and bidders will be expected not only to provide technical, but financing and local economic development solutions. Industry players, and especially NIASA, must ensure that they benchmark and evaluate themselves against the necessary guidelines for the nuclear build program, and must also take lessons from other countries that have maximized the build in their own interest. We will not be mixers of concrete or dagger boys and girls, but must be central to technology, science, engineering, and the entire EPC value chain in South Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, South Africa, like many countries globally, has to respond to climate change and the challenge it presents. However, for us as a country, while trying to address this pertinent issue, we also need to reach our developmental needs and work towards becoming a more equitable society. We need to address the triple challenges that President Zuma refers to, those of inequality, poverty, and unemployment. Program Director, more than 65% of South Africa's total energy needs are met through coal as the primary energy source, followed by crude oil at 22%, while the remaining 13% of our energy needs are met by gas, nuclear, hydro, and renewable energy sources combined. Coal therefore plays the dominant role in our supply of energy, especially in the electricity sector. We cannot, however, ignore the fact that we are a coal-rich economy, nor can we ignore the significant contribution of the coal mining industry towards the economy of South Africa. In 2010, South Africa had an estimated 32 billion tons of coal reserves, which at current local consumption rates can last up to more than 100 years. Government, however, remains committed to an increased focus on the advancement of clean coal technologies through projects such as the underground coal gasification, as well as carbon capture and storage. Ladies and gentlemen, if we are serious about diversification towards a low carbon economy, then we cannot ignore the role that natural gas and nuclear power can play as a bridging gap in this transition. Natural gas emits significantly lower greenhouse gas emissions than fossil fuels such as coal and crude oil. In comparison, nuclear power generation has close to zero contribution to greenhouse gases. South Africa is highly fuel dependent, with 34% of overall energy consumption being that of liquid fuels. Approximately 70% of this is from crude oil as a primary energy source, while the remaining 30% is from coal. The Green Economy Accord commits government to facilitate the development of a local biofuels industry and setting targets for the mandatory blending of bioethanol and biodiesel into petrol and diesel. However, Blending of biofuels alone is not sufficient in addressing the carbon footprint of the sector. And there is a need to move to cleaner fuels towards such as those already adopted in most parts of Europe. This will require substantial investments as current refining technologies will have to be overhauled to adapt to new specifications. In addition, the current refinery capacity of the petroleum industry of South Africa is not sufficient, and decisions about the expansion of the refining capacity must be made urgently. It is also increasingly important that we collaborate with our neighbors in the region, such as Mozambique, with whom we already have long-term cooperation, as well as Namibia, Angola, Botswana, Zimbabwe, and the DRC. Regional cooperation is essential if we are to tackle future energy supply successfully, while also assisting each other with our developmental needs with respect to gas and hydropower. Ladies and gentlemen, our national oil company, PetroSA, has an important role to play towards ensuring that we meet our important goals as a ministry and as a country. It is a strategic player charged with the important responsibility of ensuring security of fuel supply for our country. And it has to do so while it makes a profit without relying on the national treasury. This is not easy to do, and yet PetroSA has done it year after year. PetroSA has ambitious plans for the future, which when fulfilled will have a positive effect on the development of our country. It is important that we support it and create an environment in which it can thrive. It is our direct interest to do so because, as we know, major national oil companies of more developed nations follow a commercially oriented strategy and compete with international oil companies while delivering on their developmental mandates at home. On the African continent, Sonangol of Angola and Ghana's National Petroleum Company are also examples worthy of emulation. Like their international counterparts, these NOCs have more operational and strategic autonomy compared to our own PetroSA. Program Director and our viewers, we made an important start last year when we announced that eGas was going to be incorporated into PetroSA. Considerable progress has been made in this regard, and the process of migrating eGas to PetroSA as our NOC's gas division is nearing completion. In order to ensure sustainability of the GTL refinery, PetroSA is making steady progress in delivering on Project Equus. And I must point that strengthening the NOC is no way or in no way reduces the role and space of the private sector. There is ample space for economic coexistence of an NOC and international oil companies. But the difference is that the NOC further carries the mandate of being a developmental instrument in the hands of the state. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to restate the government's ongoing commitment to Project Mthombo, which will establish a world-class fuels hub in Kuga in the Eastern Cape. There is no doubt about it in my mind, and that a mega infrastructure project of this magnitude will have a major impact on the economy of the country in general and on the southeastern Cape Corridor, as identified by the Presidential Infrastructure Coordinating Commission, as well as to ensure security of supply of liquid fuels. I can confidently identify areas with regard to the impact of the liquid fuels charter and will more comprehensively elaborate this in the coming few weeks, because you know we did the audit. Ladies and gentlemen, our efforts at fast-tracking the licensing applications process must promote an efficient manufacturing, wholesaling, and retail petroleum industry while facilitating an environment conducive to efficient and commercially justifiable investments. It must also create the environment for the creation of employment opportunities and the development of small business in the petroleum sector, while ensuring countrywide availability of petroleum products at competitive prices. Last year, we processed 70 applications for new industry retail businesses, and 42 of these deemed economically viable, effectively contributing an estimated 5,040 direct jobs during construction and 1,260 permanent jobs. Initiatives such as the integrated energy centers, implemented in collaboration with petroleum industry role players, is aimed at promoting empowerment of our society and addressing energy poverty and access. On average, 60 temporary jobs are created during the construction construction phase of each IEC and 10 permanent jobs once the center is operational. 4 new IECs are under development this year and will contribute a further 240 construction-related jobs and 40 permanent jobs. The President, His Excellency Jacob Zuma, in his State of the Nation address earlier this year stated, and I quote, "We have also been looking at the necessity of reducing port charges as part of reducing the cost of doing business," close quotes. He also said, and I quote, "We need an electricity price path which will ensure that Eskom and the industry remain financially viable and sustainable, but which remains affordable, especially for the poor, close quotes. The same also applies to the liquid fuels industry in order to stimulate investment and therefore economic growth. In view of the continuous increases in the prices of petroleum products, the department is working on the review of the basic fuel price. In spite of the other global forces that affect the prices of petroleum products, we need to do whatever is possible within our reach to try and reduce the cost of petroleum products to the end consumers. This will help to ensure that workers do not lose their jobs due to businesses trying to cut costs." Program Director, distribution lines take the power to the last leg of the value chain, to the customer. And yet we cannot confidently speak about them in the same way we speak about generation and transmission. It does not make sense to invest trillions of rand upstream without addressing the distribution infrastructure issues. Distribution is the network that brings power to the industries, but also power to the end consumers, which is the households. On this matter, we will continue with an approach that is premised on the prioritization of regulatory matters and attention to infrastructure rehabilitation and skills development, reinforced with the implementation of the approach to distribution asset management, or the ADAM program. Ladies and gentlemen, to date, 82% of formal housing, which equates to 75% of all households, have been electrified. This is a significant achievement considering the population and household growth over the years. In less than two decades, in excess of 5.4 million new households, connections have been achieved via the grid, and more than 50,000 connections via non-grid solar panel technologies. As part of our efforts in this, the United Nations Year of Sustainable Energy Access for All, the Integrated National Electrification Program, is allocated a further 3.2 billion for this financial year, targeting an additional 150,000 grid and a further 10,000 non-grid household connections. In addition to that, we built about 10 substations annually to make sure that it makes it possible that we connect our people who are not connected. It is important to note the fact that investments in Africa's energy projects are currently the prime focus area of investors from all over the world. For South Africa to receive the advantage of this new wave of energy investments into Africa, the country needs to align itself to the preferred investor in Africa by implementing the correct measures to ensure that the value chain of energy management are correctly implemented timeously. We need our partners in the private sector to do this in collaboration with government. We need your expertise, we need your investment, and we need your experience. I want to request the financial institutions of South Africa to position themselves to be part of this huge investment boom that is coming in the South African energy sector. But please, don't put the risk bar so high that the financing risk requirements make projects not viable for the implementers, in particular South Africans emerging entrepreneurs. In conclusion, I will be amiss if I don't use this platform to urge all consumers in the country to use energy efficiently. We cannot invest billions of rand in energy generation and processing plants and we are not energy efficient. Switch off all appliances that do not need to be on. Use public transport. Think before you drive. When you have to drive with your car, but also make sure that you buy fuel efficient cars. Don't just get into the car without thinking about the efficiency of your driving. Don't first get into the car and then decide where you want to go to. Program Director, ladies and gentlemen, thank you once more for this opportunity for engagement, and I would believe that this is a platform that we need to work together on to make it possible that we've got security of supply of energy resources. I thank you.